Hi everyone, now we would be discussing the questions of paper 2. I would be taking from question 1 to question 60. But before starting, let me tell you one thing, that I am having cold, so maybe my voice would not be that much clear. So please be with me in the whole video. What I would be doing in this is, I would be sharing the screenshots of the book with every question so that you do not have a doubt after this session. So let's start with the first question. They are saying that what are the types of wound healing? So we all know in this, here you can see classification of wound closure and healing. We have primary intention, secondary intention and tertiary intention. There is nothing like quaternary intention. So answer for the first question is 1, 2 and 3. Next question. What they are saying in this is that a female came in emergency with a pain, swelling and redness following her trauma 3 days back. When we examine her, there is a swelling over the left foot and local tenderness, redness, crepitus is absent. The key word in this is that distal pulsations are palpable. Now let's come to the options. We all know that it cannot be an abscess of fasciitis. People are confused between compartment and cellulitis. But the distal pulsations are palpable, so it cannot be compartment. In compartment, we would not be having the pulsations. So the answer goes cellulitis for this. Next question, which are not associated with BRCA 1 and 2? So what are the cancer associated with BRCA 1 and 2 are? Breast cancer, ovarian cancer, papillary serous cancer and prostate cancer. So we have three of these, we don't have liver cancer in this. Next question, the malignancy associated with Stewart-Treves syndrome. So we here see that lymphangiosarcoma, Stewart-Treves syndrome. So answer for this is lymphangiosarcoma. Fifth question, what they are saying is underwent total abdominal, that means they are saying the surgery has been happened and after the surgery on the third post-operative day she suddenly became breathless. So on the basis of history, what things should come in your mind is about the pulmonary embolism. While returning from washroom, her BP is also 80/50. What is the diagnosis? According to the answer, it's thromboembolism. Again, about the lymphangiosarcoma, they are asking that a 52-year-old female underwent MRM. After few years, she developed lymphedema in the ipsilateral arm. Which malignancy can develop? So you can see that lymphangiosarcoma after radial mastectomy or MRM. So answer is lymphangiosarcoma for this. Seventh question, what they are saying is we have a gentleman of 60 years having the brownie swelling in the submandibular region and putrid halitosis. So here we can see is about Ludwig's angina. What Ludwig's angina? They are saying the features are woody brownie induration in the submandibular region, putrid halitosis. So answer for this question is Ludwig's angina. In question number 8, what they are saying is about the, they have give asking about the cancers in which the keyword is previous history of neck irradiation. So the answer is papillary carcinoma of thyroid. Question number 9, what they are saying is that unilateral swelling in the neck, cystic compressible, brilliantly transluminant. It is cystic hygroma, covering all words, compressible, child, brilliantly transluminant. So answer is cystic hygroma for this question. For the 10th question, serum thyroglobulin is an important tumor marker is. So you can see serum thyroglobulin, it is the tumor marker for all the well differentiated cancer. Then why the answer is not medullary? Because they have given for the medullary what we have is calcitonin. So answer for 10 is papillary. For the question number 11, what they are saying is a 43-year-old woman presented with serial discharge from a single duct. Controversy is going on among the groups and the various platforms, but please remember that what the UPSC is going to consider is what the book says, not what the coaching institute says. So what the book is saying about this question is, we are talking about the serous discharge and that of blood stain or serous. They are asking in the question is about the serous discharge and next keyword is single duct. So here it is serous and from the single duct. Only three things are there: fibrocystic ductectasia carcinoma. So the answer is fibrocystic ductectasia carcinoma, which is not the answer. Unlikely intraductal papilloma, because it is the blood stain discharge from single duct. I hope it is clear to you all. Next, question number 12. What they are saying is feeling of emptiness in the right iliac fossa and blood stained mucus. Main sign of Kent and red current Jerry's stool. Answer is acute intussusception. Question number 13. What is Ogilvie syndrome? It is nothing but a pseudo intestinal obstruction. So what the first statement is saying? Mechanical obstruction? No, it is a pseudo obstruction. So they were asking the, you know, in statements correct. So we all know first is wrong. So the answer become 2, 3 and 4 in this. Question number 14. What they are saying is statements about the carcinoid tumor. Again the controversial question, but what the book says is that the most common is vermiform appendix, and what they are giving is in the question terminal ileum is the most common site. Then no, appendix is the most common site. Rest all statements are given there. So the answer is 2, 3 and 4 for this question. I hope controversy would not be there anymore for this. Answer is appendix, not the terminal ileum. In familial adenomatous polyposis, which of the following are true? We all know it is autosomal dominant. So third becomes wrong. So our option is 1, 2 and 4 for this. For the 16, we all know when the CD117 comes and the large exophytic tumor of size of the fundus of stomach comes, then answer becomes GIST. Question number 17. What they are saying is not the classical symptom of acute appendicitis. We all know symptoms of appendicitis here are periamblical colic, pain shifting to right iliac, anorexia, nausea. What is not given here? Constipation. So the answer is constipation in this. Among the extraintestinal manifestation of Crohn's disease, which is, you know, extraintestinal manifestation of Crohn's disease, what we are having in our option is eye complication, iritis, uveitis. Why not other three? Because they are unrelated to disease activity. What they are asking, what is related to disease activity? So the answer is this, not these three. They are unrelated. Question 19. MELD score. MELD score, we all know Myotrick was biscuit. So B for serum bilirubin, I for INR, SC means serum creatinine. So the answer for this is 1, 3 and 4. For the question number 20, which of the following regarding to enteric perforation? One thing should be clear, that we all know TV. TV is like a television, so it is like the horizontally. But typhoid, it is like tie, so it is longitudinally. So the statement is typhoid ulcer are placed transversely, then no, it is placed longitudinally. So the third statement becomes wrong. So the answer goes 1, 2 and 4 for this. Next question 21. What they are saying is boat like rigidity on the per abdomen examination. That means peritonitis, and peritonitis happens small bowel perforation in the typhoid fever. So the answer is small bowel perforation for this. Question 22. Which of the following are options for management of pancreatic pseudocyst? So we have pancreatic pseudocyst here. We have percutaneous drainage, cystogastrostomy and the endoscopic drainage. So what we have here? We have this. One is not there. So the answer is 2 and 3, 4 for this. 23. There are statements about hepatic adenoma. We all know it is in the 25 to 50 associated with OCP and incidentally detected, but they have the malignant potential. So the not become wrongs here, and the answer is 1, 2 and 4 for this. Question number 24. They are asking about the ectopic pancreas. So I have taken the screenshot from the two different books. One is from the Belly and other from the RB. So it is saying ectopic pancreas, the location, submucosa of the stomach, duodenum, small intestine, Meckel's diverticulum, hilum of the spleen. And the next book is saying is stomach wall, small intestine, Meckel diverticulum, greater omentum and splenic hilum. So what is not mentioned in both the places is liver. So the answer for this is 1, 3 and 4. Question number 25, asking about the Kentley's line. Actually the right definition for this is between the IVC and the gallbladder. But among the statements, best option is run between gallbladder fossa and midline hepatic vein. Next question, indication of splenectomy. So what are the indications of splenectomy? The options we have here is splenic injury, ITP, hypersplenism. So we have these three. Pseudomyxoma is not there. So the answer is 2, 3 and 4. Now in this question, what they are asking is about the, actually in the history they have given the statement tiliotride. If they have mentioned about the smooth swelling in the umbilical region, freely mobile, perpendicular to mesentery, and zone of resonance all around. They have mentioned in the history here that it is freely movable in the line of attachment of the mesentery, and everything you can find in the statement. So the answer for this becomes our mesenteric cyst. Next question 28. BP is 100/70, swelling is irreducible with absence of cuff. Again, uncontroversial question, but what they are saying is in a strangulated hernia, you can see it is irreducible, obstruction to blood flow, and the swelling is tense, tender, with no impulse on cuffing and with features of intestinal obstruction. So the best answer for this is strangulated hernia. Why not obstructive? Because obstructed is only irreducible. And it is not, there is no obstruction in the blood flow. So the history doesn't matches with this. The answer is strangulated hernia. Next is Mayo's repair. Then Mayo's repair is done in the umbilical and the paraumbilical hernia. Next question, Pringle manoeuvre. We all know we clamp common bile duct, hepatic artery, portal vein. No clamping of IBC. Next question, what they are saying is bleeding from the right ear CSF leak, bruising is present behind the right ear. So they are saying about the battle sign, and it is in the fracture of the base of the skull. Commonest organism causing suppurative otitis media, it is Streptococcus pneumoniae, we all know. Next question 33, what they are saying is actually again a controversial question, because the recent guidelines says that we do the, you know, chest tube white flow cannula in the fifth intercostal space but not the second. But if you see the options, then according to the options, the again the first, second and fourth statement becomes right. We do not follow the recent guidelines in this because the answer changes, because the options are like this. Immediate chest x-ray should be done to confirm the clinical diagnosis, then we don't do it to waste our time. We directly put the needle. So the best option according to the statements given is 1, 2 and 4. Positron emission tomography, answer is distant metastatic disease. Now they ask him about ectopic ureter, it is more common in females. So the first is wrong, so answer become 2, 3 and 4 in this. In the 36, methoxyfluorine is the nephrotoxic anesthetic agent. In the 37, what they are saying is ideal parameters. So parameters are, in the severe head injury, it has been admitted neurosurgical ICU. So parameters which should be ideally maintained are PCO2 should be 4.5 to 5, mean arterial pressure should be this, PO2 should be this, but sodium should be more than 140, potassium should be more than 4, CPP more than 60 and ICP less than 20. So the answer is 1, 2 and 3 in this case. In the 38th question, untidy wounds, it is crushed ovals, contaminated, devitalized. But no loss of tissue happens in tidy wound. But the question is asking about untidy. So the answer becomes 1, 2 and 3 in this. Question number 39. What they are saying here is, which one of the following statement regarding the common crystallite solution is correct? So instead of 100, it should be 154. The second statement is right. In the third, it should be 154. And in the fourth, it should be 130. Question number 40. Perioperative benefit from transfusion is with a hemoglobin level of less than 6 gram per DL. Ideal weight gain during pregnancy for a woman with normal BMI. Statement is written directly, it's taken from the Datta that if a normal BMI should gain a weight of 11 kg and if the BMI is between 26 to 29, the weight gain should be 7 kg. They will consider the answers of the Datta in case of OVG. 42. Blood volume increases during pregnancy. The statement directly from the Datta is that blood volume starts to increase from about 6 weeks. There are maximum 40 to 50% above the non-pregnant level at 30 to 34 weeks. So answer is 40 to 50% in this case. 43. They are asking about the contraindication of external cephalic version. So we are having here is about the antepartum hemorrhage, here is there given. Then severe oligohydramnios is given and the multiple pregnancies is given. So we are left with what? The reactive non-stress test. It is not mentioned here. So you can read the contraindication of ECV from this. Antepartum hemorrhage is defined. Antepartum hemorrhage is defined after the 28th week of pregnancy. Which of the following is not a risk factor for preeclampsia? These are the risk factor of preeclampsia. These are the risk factor for preeclampsia, and nowhere placenta previus mentioned in this list. So the answer is A, B, C are true, and placenta previus not a risk factor. Question number 46, Spiegelberg criteria for the diagnosis of ovarian pregnancy. These four things are there: tube on the affected side intact, gestation sac must be in position of ovary, gestation sac connected to uterus by ovarian ligament, and ovarian tissue must be found on its wall histological examination. So all the four statements becomes right here. Which of the following statement regarding fetal well-being is not correct? So we all know that modified biophysical profile includes non-stress test and the amniotic fluid. So the answer for this is B is wrong. Again, they ask about antenatal USG examination. Then we can see here that the best dating is possible in the first trimester by measuring crown rump length. So the statements 1, 2 and 3 are right, 4th is wrong in this case. 49, what they are saying is iron supplementation. So iron supplementation is needed around these from the 16 weeks onwards. So the answer is 16 weeks here. In 50, what they are saying is clinical feature of physiological edema in pregnancy. So this explains the fact that physiological edema pregnancy subsides by rest alone, so disappear markedly reduce on rest. So answer for this 50 is D. 51, normal rate of dilation of cervix in primary gravidant phase of labor. So here we can see is if it is at the rate of 1 centimeter per hour in primary and 1.5 centimeter in multigravity. So the answer is 1 centimeter per hour in this. In the 52, what they are saying is engaging transverse diameter. So engaging transverse diameter is biparietal diameter, 9.5 centimeter. 53, what they are saying is colostrum versus breast milk. What is high in the colostrum? So among the breast milk, colostrum has the highest protein. Rest things are low as compared to breast milk. So the answer for this is higher protein content. In the 54, they are saying non-lactating mother after delivery, when ovulation happens. So in non-lactating mother, ovulation may occur as early as 4 weeks. So the answer for this is 4 weeks. 55, about the outlet forceps delivery, then bladder should be empty, cervix fully dilated, fetal skull reach level of pelvic floor, membrane should be ruptured, not intact. Vaginal pH in childbearing age, what we have here is in the childbearing period pH is 4 to 5. So the answer for this is 4 to 5.5. 57, Gartner's ducts. So Gartner's duct cyst is located in the anterolateral wall of vagina. So the answer for this is anterolateral wall of vagina. 58, endometrial sampling for diagnosis of ovulation on which day of menstrual cycle? So on which day? 21st to 23rd day of the cycle. So the answer is 21st to 23rd. Primary dysmenorrhea can be treated. It's rightly given in Datta that management of primary dysmenorrhea, you can give prostaglandins, OCPs and presacral neurectomy. Nowhere uterine curettage is mentioned. So 1, 2 and 3 statements are true for this. Last 60 question regarding obesity and infertility. We all know infertility can be associated with both the above two statements. But why first option is right here? Because here it is written that features of hypogonadotropic hypogonadism is obesity. So the answer for this question is hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. So I hope you all are clear with the answers. In this video, even I have attached the screenshots of the book lines. So maybe you can contradict me with some questions, but this UPSC considers what is written in Datta. So I have given the screenshots of the book. Then also, if you don't believe me, then sorry, I can't help you. So all the best.